I just wish Felix Mendelssohn was alive. He'd be surprised at all the attention his sister Fanny is getting. Musicians everywhere are playing her music, alongside his, and loving it. Let's get to know the Mendelssohns today on A Note to You. I'm Virginia Eskin. We're going to talk about the relationship that the brother and sister, Fanny and Felix Mendelssohn, had. And it's a very curious one because we know a lot about him. There are a lot of books about him, and we don't know much about her. That situation is changing somewhat because we live in the age of new information. And it's very interesting to me how her music radically differs from his. If we were able to hear the music that Nannerl Mozart, the older sister of Wolfgang, we would know a lot more about that relationship. Unfortunately, we don't have that music. But in the case of the Mendelssohns, we do, and it's starting to be published, and a lot of it is being played, and it's very beautiful. When you first think about it, you wonder, was he supportive? Well, yes and no. Were her parents supportive? Not really. So why did Fanny write? And I think in the end, she had the ultimate liberation. She wrote because she really wanted to. And her music shows that. It's full of passion and it's got a wily quality, which might have been her ultimate undoing. Who knows? But when you think of Mendelssohn, you think perhaps of this piece, which no wedding is complete, you know. Most weddings start with different kinds of music, but 9 out of 10 of them will wind up with that piece, which actually comes from the Midsummer Night's Dream suite that Felix Mendelssohn wrote. And it's become a famous thing, almost like Happy Birthday. And it's curious. He somehow lives in our consciousness. And I think after today's program, you're going to be intrigued and maybe you'll want to know more about Fanny. Their family life was very intimate, and they had wonderful musicales in their home. The family had the famous grandfather, Moses Mendelssohn, and he was a Talmudic scholar, very admired. And his son, Abraham, became a banker. And he was of the new ilk, which wanted to convert and not be terribly Jewish. And because they had converted, they were allowed to live outside the ghetto, and which meant that they were of a liberated sort, and they had wonderful musicales every Sunday, and famous people would come. Goethe was a constant house guest, and all the children not only played and sang and composed, they also drew, and Fanny also had the problem of being on the small side, and she had inherited a hump, like a deformity. One shoulder blade was lower than the other. And she wasn't terribly pretty, so I think that her father was protecting her by not encouraging her to be a composer. But of course, that was a cruel thing for him to do. And she composed music anyway. And everything you read about their relationship, Fanny and Felix, is just like two doves. Everything he composed, he wanted her approbation. That is not so of everything she composed. It turns out that at some point, he thought he was doing her a favor, and he published some of her music under his name. So it makes research very difficult. The thing that I am struck by is the very sort of tender quality of her music, and she does dare to be a little wild. And I'd like to play just a little song without words that she composed, and it has a dear story that goes with it. When he was in England, he was asked to play at the court, and Queen Victoria was very taken by this piece. And he said, oh, but you should hear my sister play. And that would have been the moment for him to say, she actually composed this. But he didn't. Thank you. That was just A Song Without Words that I played for you in the key of D-flat, Opus 8, written by Fanny Mendelssohn. And at that same time, when Felix was in England, when he played that little piece and didn't tell the Queen it was by his sister, he was in a coach and the coach overturned and he got badly hurt and sort of laid up. And even though he was being lionized by the society in London, he was not able to get busy writing something for her upcoming wedding. And it's interesting that Fanny's mother had taken a very dim view of Wilhelm Hensel. And in fact, she'd sort of forbidden him to write and had made him go to Italy and keep studying because he was a very fine artist. And fortunately for us, she didn't have her sort of wicked way. And eventually they do get married. And because he made all these beautiful line drawings, we know what the family looked like. So he comes back, Hensel, and they decide to get married. And even though Felix had promised to write something for the wedding, because of course his beloved sister finally getting married, and both of them married very late in life. They were not quick to marry. They were, I think, very serious. And it's not that they had any kind of incestuous relationship, not at all. They were just on the shy, serious side, and probably finding a suitable mate was not easy. So anyway, Fanny decides to get married, and she writes to him and says, are you going to help me with something for my wedding? And because of his hand being hurt from the coach accident, he delays, and the wedding goes ahead anyway, and she has to wind up writing her own prelude for her wedding. And here we have a very nice recording by a Fanny Mendelssohn scholar, Victoria Sirota, and this is Fanny's wedding prelude.
Thank you.
was Fanny Mendelssohn's own wedding prelude that she composed for her own wedding, played by Victoria Sirota. I just love to learn about sisters and brothers, and, you know, you always think of sibling rivalry, and I think you have to realize that Felix was very protective of his sister. It's true he didn't help her career, but it wasn't the age, and composing and publishing he regarded as a sort of a rugged arena, and he said that the public was equally likely to throw sand as roses. You know, it's sort of, for your own good, dear, we're not going to help you. And she still composed music, though, and there's a lot of it. She wrote a lot of songs, piano music, a trio, string quartet, no symphonies, alas, and no operas or anything like that. But the miracle is, because she died quite young, that she wrote as much as she did. Now, Felix was, of course, the much more successful one of the two, and he started to travel. And even though he got terrible seasickness, apparently, he still was compelled to go over to England quite often. And one of those trips, he went all the way up to Scotland, and he was climbing through Holyrood Castle, where Mary, Queen of Scots, had worshipped, and he was very taken by all of this. And he apparently took a little side trip over to a basalt cavern on the tiny island of Staffa, which is in the Hebrides, and he wrote quite a lot of music. All of his music has this very upbeat quality. You can hear fairies leaping around, and it's very fast moving. The signal from both Mendelssohns is a very fast one, and they apparently had a little code amongst them. It was said that if she heard him playing something that she didn't approve of, she'd sort of cough a lot. And likewise, if she was playing something and he wanted to say in some secret code that he didn't approve of, so he'd sort of and they were very, very close. Everything that he wrote, he always showed it to her, and all the letters say, oh, it sounds so beautiful, and she doesn't seem to criticize anything. She just mainly is very supportive of him. Let's listen to the third movement of Felix's Scottish Symphony, because it speaks to what sort of experience he was having up in Scotland. It's very lively. Thank you. That was the scherzo movement of Felix Mendelssohn's Scottish Symphony, played by the Chicago Symphony, conducted by Sir Georg Schulte. And we're sort of exploring what makes the difference between Fanny and Felix Mendelssohn. And there is a big difference. Unfortunately, when I was listening to that, I was thinking how much Felix loved the interval of a fourth. Did you hear that? And so did Fanny. They love fourths. And, of course, Beethoven loved thirds. And composers tend to, I think when they sit down to the piano, they just, they're comfortable. They start to play something that's comfortable to them. And inevitably, their music has a certain sound. Let's listen to another piece taken from that time when Felix was visiting Scotland. And it is rather moody because he had gone to visit a cave, and he was very taken by the Scottish countryside, and apparently he didn't have any accidents there, because it's not, I don't think he was accident prone, but he had to take care of himself, and he was very sensitive, and he didn't like folk music. He didn't even like Beethoven's folk songs. He didn't like Scotch bagpipes, Swiss cowhorns, Welsh harps, and he didn't like people standing outside his room serenading him, because the word would be out that a famous musician was visiting. And so country musicians would come over and he would shower them with money, asking them, go away! He couldn't stand because they probably sang out of tune. Let's listen to Fingal's Cave. And imagine you're up on a very cloudy, murky, big seascape, and you've gone into a cavern. And this is what Mendelssohn felt he heard.
Thank you.
That was a portion of the Fingal's Cave Overture by Felix Mendelssohn, played by the New York Philharmonic, with Leonard Bernstein conducting. And I couldn't help but feel, there he is, he's imitating himself. Some more of those fourths. And then there's a little bit of his violin concerto thrown in. All composers imitate themselves. And I'd like to play just a little demo now of what I've been talking about, how different his music is from hers. Here's the beginning of one of Felix's Song Without Words for piano, and notice how predictable and very elegant it is. And then I'm going to play a little bit of one she wrote and how unpredictable it is. Here's his. You get the feeling there, those three notes, like three columns. Now, she, in the same key, listen to how Fanny goes off on a sort of a wild chase. How different it is. And what's happening is a very interesting musical sandwich. She's putting the melody in the middle of the voices. There's the bass that supports it, and then there's the melody. But she writes all the filigree all around it, which makes it very hard because the thumbs, that are sort of the stupid members of the human hand, they have to cope with the melody. And his is much more playable. His melody is on the top. It goes. So it's much easier because the right hand can just concentrate on that melody and the left hand accompanies itself. And that may be also a reason why pianists have not been quick to take up her music till the women's movement mandated it, and now it's fortunately published, and you can study it and learn it and make a comparison, and it's very, very interesting. And I think we're the richer for having both of their kinds of music. Let's listen to the fourth movement of Fanny's string quartet, and it has some of that same very fast-moving signal that I've been talking about. Thank you. I really like the sound of that. That was the last movement from Fanny Mendelssohn's string quartet. And it was, I think, beautifully played by the Erato Quartet based in Basel. I'm Virginia Eskin, and today on A Note to You, we're taking a good look at the fascinating lives of Felix and Fanny Mendelssohn. If you have comments about the program, I'd really love to hear from you. Our address is A Note to You, care of WGBH Radio, 125 Western Avenue, Boston, Massachusetts, 02134. The email address is anotetoyou@wgbh.org. A Note to You is made possible by the friends and alumni of Northeastern University. We're going to have another little tasting, a little comparison. We're going to hear Felix Mendelssohn's first movement of his C minor trio, but I want to point out again how similar Fanny's music can be, similar and dissimilar. She wrote a trio, it's Opus 11, so she's pretty young, must be in her early 20s when she writes it, and it's very difficult, and his is so reliable again. He starts off... Hear those fourths? And what that does is establish a very nice sort of stately quality to the music. And listen how she starts hers. It's like a wild thing. It's like a piano concerto. And on... And the string players have interesting things to play. She's very aware of what the cello and the viola can do, and she even gives some little sort of cadenzas to them. And as you just heard in that string quartet, she certainly knew how to write for string players. There are no flies on her. She's, I think, Felix's equal when it comes to very able writing. But again, it's not easily put together, because I know from playing this trio, you have to rehearse it. And whenever that happens, musicians tend to be rather lazy. We all sort of like stuff that falls together. Let's listen to his trio. I think it's a wonderful piece. I just happened to play it recently. I like this C minor trio. That was just a portion of Felix Mendelssohn's C minor trio, played by the masters, Isaac Stern, Leonard Rose, and Eugene Istomin. Let's now go to a different style of music. Fanny Mendelssohn wrote a lot of beautiful songs, and of course Felix did too, and she tended to carry over that sort of wild, frantic quality that I find in her music. It's called Frühling, which means spring, and I love the words, and I think it's appropriate for this time of year. She says, over the garden, through the air, that means spring scents, and everything is starting to bloom. I want to shout, I want to weep. She's obviously lovesick. And it's just a wonderful song, and I'm looking at the music here, and it fibrillates. It just cavorts all over the place. And listen to how it changes keys. It goes. Mm-hmm. It's all over the map. It's, I think, quite a challenge to play. Well, here it is. Let's listen to Frühling by Fanny Mendelssohn. This is Susan Gritton singing. Two songs by Fanny Mendelssohn, sung by Susan Gritton and accompanied by Eugene Asti. And the second one was My Heart is Yours, My Pain Your Own, and All the Pleasures, and the Forest and the Branches and the Blossoms. It's such a beautiful song, and the way Fanny expresses the pain and the pleasure is very interesting chromatically, because it starts off...
Thank you.
then it goes to minor. That's the pain. And then back to the pleasure. And then sort of like palpitations of the heart. I just think the way she writes the songs is terribly expressive. And Felix's songs are very beautiful too. It's just they're much more straightforward. She's very willing to go way out on a limb. Now, Felix, I'd mentioned before, loved to travel, and Fanny did not. She was busy staying at home, busy being married, and she was also a conductor of a chorus at her church. And eventually, that's where she dies, during one of her rehearsals. But let's go to Italy and hear a movement from Felix's Italian symphony, because it has a very Italian flavor. We're going to talk about gondolas in a minute.
Thank you.
whirling dervishes, Italian style. Saltarello, the presto movement from Felix Mendelssohn's Italian Symphony, played by the Chicago Symphony Orchestra with Sir Georg Schulte conducting. And I found myself thinking, it sounds a little bit like a tarantella, that sort of... fast-moving, ribbons flying, and pastrami out the window. Pizza for everybody. Now we're going to listen to a song without words. It's actually a Venetian gondola song. I'd like to talk a little bit about the style when the Mendelssohns wanted to sort of depict a gondola. What do they fall back on? Their fourths, and it's got this kind of rocking motion. And I should say that Fanny did get to go to Italy in 1839, and apparently she had some of the happiest years of her life there. Let's go now to analyzing, how do you sound like a gondola in music? Well, you have a rocking motion. A little bit like Godfather music. Here's Felix Mendelssohn's Venetian Barcarolle, played by Daniel Barenboim. That was a Venetian Barcarolle played by Daniel Barenboim, written by Felix Mendelssohn. And we're going to end the program today with something I'd like to play for you. It's one of Fanny Mendelssohn's songs without words, and it's called September on the River, and it's very wild. Fanny Mendelssohn's Song Without Words in B minor, and I enjoy playing it. And did you hear how my thumbs had to work making that melody? It's sort of the hardest thing for a pianist to do, make a melody out of the middle of your hands. Well, I hope you enjoyed today's program. I hope you feel you know a little bit more about the Mendelssohn family, and maybe it'll pique your interest, and you'll listen or learn some of her music. It's certainly well worth it. Our engineer today has been Alan Mattis. Our producer is Alan McClellan, and I'm Virginia Eskin. A Note to You is made possible by the friends and alumni of Northeastern University. It's produced by Northeastern University in cooperation with WGBH Radio, Boston.